announced its decision to disinvest 20% of the equity of Indian Airlines and Air India. It has also opened up the skies for private air taxi operators. In view of these developments, India is being seen as a big market for civil aviation aircraft. Nirupama Sekri reports on Avia 91, a first-of-its-kind exhibition on aviation held in New Delhi recently.
I do extend to you as civil aviation minister a very, very warm welcome. India is opening up fast. We are determined to carry out the policies of liberalization and opening up. There are major expansion plans on the anvil in India. Our own airlines, Air India and Indian Airlines, have drawn up quite an ambitious fleet renewal and fleet expansion plan to deal hopefully with the large influx of tourists that we are desiring in our country. There is a major expansion of airports and airfields, and all the equipment that goes along with this is an area of major interest now in this country.
In a specialized and dynamic field such as aviation, dialogue and sharing of technological information is very important. And it is this awareness that was expressed in Avia India 91, the first ever international exhibition and conference on aviation and airports to be held in India. The exhibition, which was held at New Delhi's Ashoka Hotel, was organized by Convex, a company which has held exhibitions on various technical subjects in the past.
This is a, shall we say, a focal point where people who are exhibiting have a product to sell or to display, or maybe offering technology for manufacturing. The attendees who come to see are people from the aviation business who are interested in talking in detail to the exhibitors here. They are not here to collect plastic bags or little models or kits like that. So this is serious business.
India is viewed as a huge potential market for aviation infrastructure, a fact proved by the 28 exhibitors who came from the US, USSR, Canada and UK.
We certainly feel in Boeing that India is one of the largest markets, and Air India has been our customer for the last 30 years. So to show our interest in India and to show the appreciation for the business we got and hope to continue our relationship with India, we decided to take a rather large booth and display all our products.
We see the Indian market as having very great potential for civil aircraft over the next 10, 15 years, both in terms of aircraft replacement, replacing the older fleet, and in terms of fleet expansion. Wherever there's a need for civil aircraft, there's a need for Rolls-Royce engines as well. We have a whole spectrum of engines to cover aircraft from Boeing, McDonnell Douglas and Airbus. And we see this as a good forum for presenting Rolls-Royce, the Rolls-Royce image, and what we have to offer to the general Indian aviation market.
Products ranging from Rolls-Royce engines to Boeing aircrafts to Russian rescue planes, security and safety systems, terminal equipment were on display with top-notch people associated with aviation and airports in India in attendance.
Raytheon Company was very anxious to come to India so we could expose our air traffic control equipment to the Indian population. Additionally, Raytheon is a bidder on the modernization of air traffic services for Bombay and New Delhi.
A Beriev Taganrog Aviation representative explained the use of the Model 42 Russian aircraft, a multi-purpose aeroplane that could land on water, one which they think would be especially useful to the Asian region, which has many islands. This stall too received many inquiries like most others did.
We've been very gratified with the response. A lot of interest from the general public. Of course, we keep naturally our good relations going with both Indian Airlines and Air India. We have contact with them anyway. We've seen a good general response from most areas within the Indian aviation circles.
European manufacturers, however, were conspicuous by their absence.
But I heard this morning that somebody actually told
some very senior people in the Ministry of Aviation and also in the Air Force that the French are now regretting the fact that they were not in the show. But by and large, it's been excellent response.
And I'm pretty pleased the way it's going so far. We see a lot of companies here. I was at the technical presentations this morning, and they have been very useful and enlightening. So I think for the first, it's done very well. Of course, it is not in the same league as the Paris Air Show, but they've been going on for 60 years now.
Although not in the league of international exhibitions, Avia India 91 brought together the aviation fraternity and served as a platform for sharing information, an effort commendable in its aim.
Almost to cock a snook at the fate of the MiG, the Sukhoi 27 Flanker put on a stunning display. Pulling up vertically from his takeoff, Pugachev hung onto the power of his twin Tumansky turbofans to force the aircraft into a staggeringly impressive series of turns and loops. The aircraft has over 1-to-1 power-to-weight ratio, and with large control surfaces, she can maneuver with great speed and precision. Unlike the MiG, this aircraft is fly-by-wire with a quadruple backup system. She's also tipped as the new Soviet naval fighter, if and when they finish their carrier building program. And with reheat on, the R-32 engines can take her over Mach 2, though how much isn't known. One distinctive maneuver was the tail slide, almost a salute to the MiG, who had demonstrated it last summer at Farnborough. Of course, this is entirely standard as a defensive move against missile radar, which detects fast movement. The Sukhoi, in a stripped-down form, the P-42, claims several climb-to-altitude records, including an amazing ground to 7.5 miles up in just under 1 minute. This is non-standard, a stylish nod to the spectators, who much appreciated it. A spontaneous reaction to Viktor Pugachev, test pilot and showman.
This is the crowd's eye view of one of the new formations for 1989, Big Vixen. We're now going to give you the opportunity to enjoy the view from the hot seats, actually inside Tim Miller's cockpit. the years, the RAF's aerobatic teams have used a variety of aircraft, the NAT, jet provosts, and for many the most famous operational aircraft, the Hawker Hunter. However, today they rely upon one of Britain's most successful aviation exports, the British Aerospace Hawk.
The Red Arrow's tribute to the spacecraft that first placed a man on the moon on the 20th of July, 1969, 20 years ago. Watch now as they twist in the descent out of that loop, sufficient position in front of you for another good photo during the Apollo bend.
From the manoeuvre, known as Leader's Benefit, we go to the point where the Red Arrows put on two quite separate displays. Seven aircraft move into the big seven, and the synchro pair split and form a heart. This year, synchro is made up of Flight Lieutenant John Rance in his third and final year with the Arrows, and Flight Lieutenant Steve Johnson in his second year.
And as the colour comes on, here come two and three for the rollbacks. Now four and five has centre stage. And it's the turn of eight and nine to complete the manoeuvre. Top of the loop, watch it for a while.
spotlight may be on the 9 display pilots. However, the Red Arrows have a tremendous team providing technical backup. And their team manager is squadron leader Andy Stewart, who you can hear providing this year's commentary. Happy birthday, Red Arrows, and thank you for 25 scintillating years.